Welcome to The Explainer. Today, we're talking about something called open source intelligence, or OSINT for short. Now, this isn't about stealing secrets from some high security vault. It's about piecing together clues. Clues that you, me, all of us might be leaving online right now, hiding in plain sight.
Okay, that sounds like a crazy question, right? Something straight out of a spy movie. But here's the thing, it's not only possible, we're actually gonna walk through exactly how it's done in this explainer. You're about to see how one single, totally innocent-looking photo can become the key to unlocking a person's entire digital life.
So here's what we've got on tap. We'll kick things off with what OSINT really is. Then we'll check out an analyst toolkit. After that, we'll dive into a wild case study starting from just a photo. And then, the really important part, we'll get into how you can protect yourself and even run your own self-audit.
All right, first up, hiding in plain sight. So what on earth is OSINT?
Okay, so the definition might sound a little formal, but the most important words right there are publicly available sources. Let's be super clear. This has nothing to do with hacking or anything illegal. We're talking about information that people have already put out there, you know, on social media, on blogs, in public records, often without thinking about it. Really, OSINT is the art of connecting all those little dots scattered across the internet.
I love this quote. It really hits the nail on the head. You know, when you Google your own name, you're just scratching the surface. And OSINT analysts, though, they're going way, way deeper. They're using special techniques to find things like that old forum post you made 10 years ago under a totally different username, or maybe even cached versions of websites that you thought were gone forever.
And look, this isn't some theoretical exercise. It's happening in the real world every single day. In cybersecurity, for example, the good guys use OSINT to find weaknesses before the bad guys do, like finding a list of employee emails just floating around online. Corporations use it for due diligence, HR departments use it to check out job candidates. Heck, journalists use it for deep dive investigations, and it's even helped solve missing persons cases. It's serious stuff.
Okay, so how does someone actually find all this stuff? Well, let's open up the Digital Detectives Toolkit and take a look.
So here are just a few of the heavy hitters. You've got a tool like Sherlock. You give it one username and it blasts it out across more than 300 social networks and websites to see where it pops up. Then there's Holhi, which is really clever. You give it an email and it goes to a bunch of websites and tries to create an account. If it gets an error message like, hey, that email's already in use, boom, you know an account exists. ExivTool, that's for digging into the hidden data, the metadata, in files like photos. And then there's Shodan. Whoa, Shodan is on a whole other level. It's not a search engine for websites. It's a search engine for things connected to the internet. We're talking webcams, servers, traffic lights, you name it, it's wild.
But with all these fancy, specialized tools, you can't forget about the most powerful one of all, and it's one you already use every single day. Yeah, I'm talking about Google. With the right know-how, it is an absolute beast for this stuff.
This right here is an example of what's called Google dorking. It's basically using special commands to tell Google exactly what you want. So this little search query, site linkedin.com/gmail.com, is telling Google, hey, I only want you to look at linkedin.com, and I want you to find every single page that mentions gmail.com. And what do you get? A massive list of public LinkedIn profiles where people have, for some reason, put their personal Gmail address right out there for the world to see. It's shockingly simple and incredibly powerful.
Okay, so enough with the theory. Let's see how this all works in the real world. We're gonna run a full investigation, and we're starting with just one single thing. A photograph. And not just any photograph, a really, really famous one.
So here's our game plan. First, we're gonna analyze the image file itself for any hidden clues. As soon as we find something, we're gonna pivot, that's the keyword, and use that clue to find more info. We'll just keep building the profile piece by piece until we uncover the final big secret. And our starting point for all of this, believe it or not, it's that iconic Windows XP wallpaper. Yeah, that one.
And right away, we get our first breakthrough. We run that image file through ExivTool, that tool we talked about earlier, and what it does is it reads all the hidden data that's attached to the file, the metadata. And look what we find. Buried in the copyright field, the name OWoodFlint. That looks an awful lot like a username, doesn't it?
And here's where the investigation really takes off. This is where we pivot. The whole game in OSINT is taking one tiny piece of information and using it to unlock the next one, and then the next one. That one username, OWoodFlint, is the key to everything. So what do? A simple Google search for @OWoodFlint. And just like that, the floodgates open. We immediately get hits for a GitHub profile, a Twitter account, and a personal blog.
This is such a common mistake people make, right? We reuse the same username everywhere for convenience. But what we're really doing is creating a perfect trail of digital breadcrumbs for anyone to follow.
Okay, now we just start pulling information from all these different places. On GitHub, his bio lists his city as London and gives us his personal email. Over on Twitter, we see his profile picture is a photo of a cat. And on his blog, he actually posted that he's on vacation in New York right now. Let's just pause for a second. From one photo, we now have his username, his email, his home city, his current location, and we even know what his avatar looks like. It's insane.
But his blog had an even juicier, more technical clue. He posted something called a BSSID. So think of it this way. Every single Wi-Fi router has a unique serial number, kind of like a MAC address. That's its BSSID. You see the friendly name, like My Awesome Wi-Fi, but your phone sees this long string of letters and numbers. And for some reason, he just posted it on his blog.
Well, it turns out there are public databases, like a website called wiggle.net, that have mapped millions and millions of Wi-Fi networks all over the world. So we just plug that BSID into the database, and what do you know? We get a match. The public name for that network is Unilever Wi-Fi, and its last known location was, you guessed it, London. This is a huge clue. It basically confirms he's in London and very, very likely works at Unilever.
Okay, so we've got his email, we know where he lives, we probably know where he works, we even know he's on vacation. But what about the password? I mean, no way a password would just be out there, right? Well, you'd be surprised. The answer was on his blog the whole time. It wasn't something you could see just by looking at the page. But if you view the page's source code, you know, the raw HTML that makes up the website, you can see everything. And there it was. It looks like he left himself a little note, but tried to hide it by making the text white on a white background, so it's invisible. But a simple Control-A to select all text on the page, and there it is. The password, Penny Stretcher. Game over. A total compromise. And it all started from one single photo.
Yeah, seeing all that play out is a little terrifying, right? And it should be a bit of a wake-up call. But here's the good news. Now that you know how it works, you can start defending against it. So let's talk about how you can build your own digital fortress.
Okay, so here's a simple four-step strategy. Number one, and this is the big one, just limit your public oversharing. Seriously, think twice before you post off to Hawaii for 2 weeks. You're basically putting up a giant sign that says, my house is empty. Number two, use different usernames and different emails for different things. Don't use the same handle for your gaming forum that you use for your LinkedIn profile. It just connects the dots too easily. Three, strip that metadata from your photos before you post them. There are plenty of free tools online that do this. And finally, number four, you gotta do a self-audit every now and then. Basically, you need to use these techniques on yourself to see what's out there.
So that last point, the self-audit, is probably the most important thing you can do. So where do you even begin?
A fantastic place to start is this website called Have I Been Pwned? It's super simple. You just type in your email address, and it will check it against this gigantic database of all the major data breaches that have ever happened. You know, from places like LinkedIn, Adobe, you name it. It'll tell you if your email and, more importantly, the password you used for that site has been leaked. If you get a hit, you need to go change that password immediately, especially if you reused it anywhere else.
Look, at the end of the day, everything you do online leaves a trace. It builds a digital footprint that tells a story about you. The techniques we went through today, they're not magic. They're just a way for someone to read the story that's already been written. So the real question you have to ask yourself is, are you the one in control of that story?